Welcome to Someone Talked, the official podcast of the National D-Day Memorial, where leading experts spill all the secrets of the Second World War, with your host, Dr. John C. McManus.
Greetings. Welcome to Someone Talked. I'm your host, Dr. John C. McManus, Curator's Distinguished Professor, U.S. Military History at Missouri S&T. And alongside, as always, are my very good buddies, April Cheek Messier and John Long from the National D-Day Memorial Foundation. How goes it today?
Wonderful. Great to be here.
All goes well. We're looking forward to this.
Yeah, absolutely. This is, we always have a great time with this. It's just incredible honor to have these remarkable historians on. But today, of course, if there's a first among equals, I mean, it's James Holland, who, of course, I can't be unbiased about James. I'm not pretending to be otherwise. He's a good buddy of mine, too. But I just want to just give a little bit of overview of James's career to kind of frame what we'll be talking about today. I mean, James is, by any measure, really one of the leading historians of World War II in the world right now. He's the author, of course, dozens of books, not all about World War II and not all nonfiction. He's written novels. He's written young adult books in terms of television series and documentaries. He's always on the cutting edge. He's got so many productions going. I can never even keep track of what all he's doing. And of course, he hosts one of the great World War II oriented podcasts on the planet, which is We Have Ways of Making It Talk alongside Al Murray. And then one I'm partial to, a spinoff that we do together called We Have Ways Making It Talk in the USA, which Jim and I host alongside Al Murray. And it's just a blast. So obviously, you know, we're partners in crime as well. But more to the point, what we wanted to have James on to discuss today was his latest book, which is called The Savage Storm, The Battle for Italy, 1943. And, you know, it's really interesting because the Italian campaign, I think, kind of gets lost in the maw of World War II historiography or memory, maybe. We certainly do tend to fixate on Normandy, and maybe for good reason, or the Bulge, or you know, from a British perspective, maybe the Battle of Britain or Dunkirk or the Desert War or whatever. But, you know, I don't think there's quite enough done on the Italian campaign until James has really taken this on. And I really believe that there is no historian, certainly writing in English, in the English language right now, who is really better versed with the war in Italy, with the ground. It seems like practically every other week when I'm in touch with James that he's in Italy and he's exploring Monte whatever, you fill in the blank. It's basically a series of hills. And this really comes to life in the book because James knows the ground so well, and then he's brought to life a lot of the people who fought on both sides he's really skewed toward contemporary sources and whatnot. So, James, it's a pleasure to have you on today. And the place where I wanted to begin in discussing Italy, is with what's called Operation Giant 2. Now, just by way of background, Giant 2 was this sort of plan to drop the 82nd Airborne Division in the environs of Rome during that period after Mussolini is deposed, when Marshal Pietro Badoglio's in charge of the Italian government and nominally is keeping Italy in the war on Germany's side. But obviously, behind the scenes, he's trying to negotiate a way out with the Allies. And what the Italians want is for us to give them some kind of combat power in Rome to help facilitate a kind of an allied occupation of the country that will forestall the Germans from doing the same. And so there's this whole operation on the books in which the All-American Division is going to get dropped there way behind what could be German lines, far beyond our supply lines, really difficult to kind of reinforce to in terms of the aviation side. And the commanding general of the 82nd Airborne Division, Major General Matthew Ridgway, is like dead set opposed to this. And so, James, you talk about this in the book. And so I wanted to kind of, I know what I think of Giant 2. I think it's one of the dumbest ideas ever conceived in the history of the war, in my opinion. But I wanted to bounce it off you and see like how you look at it, and I, you know, and how you brought it to life in the book. What's your take?
Yeah, well, it is a bonkers idea, and I think it is interesting because I think what people are trying to do is that And this goes back to the whole kind of premise of Operation Avalanche, which is the prime landing, which takes place in the early hours of the 9th of September, 1943. And the Allies, they want to go into Italy for some very, very good reasons. And they think it's worth it, but they haven't got enough assault shipping to do what they want to do in the scale that they want to do. They've got no shortage of manpower. They've got no shortage of guns or equipment or anything like that. What they've got a shortage of is assault craft. And you can only do what you can do with the assault craft you've got. And the U.S. Fifth Army has got 359 assault craft for Operation Avalanche, which is nothing like enough. But that's going to be okay, the chiefs of staff and the planners reason, because they've intercepted some tiny little bit of information from a decrypt of German radio traffic back in May 1943 that suggests that should the Allies ever invade mainland Italy, the Germans would retreat to the Pisa-Rimini line. Now, that's about 200 miles north, and it's the only bit in Italy where the mountains absolutely run from one side of the coast to the other uninterrupted. There are mountain passes, but there's no kind of sort of low valley or flat bit or anything like that. So there's very good reasons for that. And the reasons for doing it are because then you've got shorter lines of communication. You're not kind of get so exposed to Allied air power and blah, blah, blah. And at the same time, they're also hoping that another force. So that's one thing. So if they can get an easy, they're not going to need that many landing craft if the Germans are just going to retreat to the Pisa-Rimini line. They're spending a little bit of a fight, but there is, you see me, that the Germans will pay kind of lip service. They'll do a bit of a scrap and then they'll retreat north of Rome and the Allies will just walk in. So that's how they convince themselves that they don't need quite as many troops landing as they might normally do, and how they can get away with such a small amount of assault craft. Then in the course of the negotiations, the armistice negotiations with the Italians betray a kind of certain nervousness that what's going to happen the moment they surrender, the Germans are going to come in and kind of rip the heart out of them. And they have very good reason for being worried about this, because that is exactly what the Germans are planning to do. And the Allies keep going, yeah, but what you want to do is, you know, you've got lots of troops, just resist the Germans, you know, and turn the guns against the Germans and not onto us. So, you know, there's lots of coastal guns all the way down the west coast of Italy and manned by Italian servicemen. And, you know, the Allies say to them, well, it's really simple. Just don't give them to the Germans and turn them on the Germans instead. And the Italians sort of go, yeah, but, you know, the problem is we're really under-equipped, you know, morale is shot, you know, we kind of like to do that in theory, but the problem is that the Germans are running the show in Italy now, and they're dominating the roads, and they're dominating the fuel supplies, and they're dominating the ammunition. We haven't got quite enough, and we'll absolutely tell all our guys to do this, but, you know, we're a bit worried about it. And what would really help is if we knew that, you know, perhaps you were, you know, I know you can't say where you're going to land, but if we knew it was going to be somewhere near Rome, that would be helpful. And perhaps, you know, if you could send in some troops and they could help stiffen resolve in Rome, then maybe that'd be a good thing. And so suddenly there they've got the Allies have got this 82nd Airborne, and the Airborne is a floating division that is to be there to be used, you know, in the plan, not in the initial invasion. That was never part of Operation Avalanche. They're there to be used kind of wherever they're most suitable to be used, and whether that's a kind of, you know, securing the roads north of Salerno to Naples or a key mountain pass, or whether that's to bolster the troops on you know, in the bridgehead in Salerno or whatever, all TBC. But they're there, they're ready to go, and it's just a question of giving them the order. So suddenly someone goes, well, hang on a minute, you know, the Italians are wavering. You know, the Italian support is so important to this invasion. Maybe this is the time to use the 82nd Airborne. And you can see the Allied kind of planners sort of going, yeah, that could be a solution. Yeah, that could, you know, lots of gung-ho kind of, you know, square-jawed, great-teeth, butch American paratroopers going into Rome. That could be just the fillip that those pesky Italian motorized corps in Rome needs. And so it gets a bit like the invasion itself. It gets a momentum all of its own. When you look at how crazy Giant is, this idea of sending in the airborne airborne into Rome, there's also a difference, because when the Italians first kind of go, well, that could really help, what they're imagining is that the entire 82nd Airborne will land simultaneously on one night and will suddenly smother Rome, and that'll be that. And there is this massive gulf between imagining what will happen and the actual reality from the Italian point of view. But at this point of view, what you have to remember is that the whole Avalanche plan is pretty bonkers, full stop, because the Allies are abandoning their kind of very risk-averse approach, i.e. build up overwhelming force, make sure that the chances of you having a reverse are absolutely minimal, to chucking the kitchen sink at something and hoping it's, you know, chucking lots of mud at the wall and hoping, just hoping and praying against, you know, all hope that, that this is going to work. So I would argue that the Giant and Giant 2 is the 82nd Airborne plan for Rome. Yes, it's mad, but so is Avalanche. That's the point of it. It's just that we've accepted that Avalanche was okay because by the 17th of September, they're still there and the invasion proves a success and, you know, phew, they've got away with it. But Avalanche is so high risk, it's not true. And when one is looking at Salerno and looking at the Avalanche invasion of Fifth Army, you really do need to check the statistics and go, am I looking at this right? Really, only 359 aircraft, only 70 warships, you know, and when to you and I today in 2024, that sounds like an awful lot. By Second World War standards, it absolutely isn't. By Allied amphibious invasion standards, it absolutely isn't. This is chicken feed. And there's so many things that can go wrong with Avalanche. And frankly, it's a miracle that they survive. And it's really, it's 50%, you know, the brilliance of Fifth Army, and it's 50% the kind of total cock-up of the Germans in defending it and counterattacking. I mean, they just, you know, Kesselring, who is the German commander, has chucked all his eggs into one basket and throws everything at trying to get Fifth Army out of the beaches and back into the sea, and it fails and leaves himself fatally exposed on the southeast corner of Italy as a result of it, and the consequence, disaster. But you know, I'm jumping ahead here. So when one looks at Giant, yes, it is bonkers, but it's only marginally more bonkers than Avalanche, I'd argue.
It's an offshoot of something that's already bonkers.
That's my point.
Got more bonkers, and so Ridgway sees it. And what I find interesting is someone doing a biography of Ridgway right now is that, I mean, he's willing to put end his career up this. This is a very interesting situation in which he could have just said, yes, sir, we'll do it, you know, can do, you know, the whole sort of airborne thing. And he's like, no, I am not on board with this. And he's only going to do it under extreme duress. And then he's famously called off at the last minute. Lyman Lemnitzer has to come in and tell him even some of the planes are in the air and all this. Yeah. It really could have turned out quite differently. Because
I mean, the interesting thing is that one of the reasons why it is cancelled is because Maxwell Taylor, you know, what the concession that Ridgway gets is that someone needs to go in and just, you know, you can't just land, you know, sort of blind on
you
need to go and do a recce, you know, and funny enough, you know, Mark Clark does a recce before the torch, for example. It's a kind of, you know, I think one needs to look at Maxwell Taylor's kind of mission to Rome. On the kind of 8th of September 1943, one has to look at it in the same kind of light, really. And when he gets there, what he realizes in very quick order is that what he thinks is practicable and what he thinks that the 82nd is capable of is a long way short of what the Italians, in this case Giacomo Carboni, who is the commander of the Italian motorized armored corps, is expecting. And credit where credit's due, Carboni realizes it's exactly the same. He just says this is going to be a complete disaster. And so on the morning of the 8th of September, the day that the armistice is about to be announced in the evening, Taylor signals back and says, we've got to cancel this. We've got to cancel this. And as you rightly point out, John, it's only in the nick of time that...
Well, and you know what else is fascinating about this, Jim, is that I found years later, certainly, you know, the Italian military guys said, yeah, Giant 2 should have happened. It would have saved us the hell of fighting that campaign in southern Italy and, you know, all this stuff that's just absurd on its face. But you'd maybe expect them to say that. But you know who else said something of the same thing? Beadle Smith, Eisenhower's chief of staff. He writes a letter in which he says, you know what? We should have sent someone in there other than Taylor. Taylor had the wrong perspective. We needed somebody with a different kind of diplomatic perspective. My eyes practically popped out of my skull. That even all those years later, somebody like Beadle Smith would still think this was a good idea. So
I find that astonishing. That's astonishing.
Isn't that amazing?
It really is, because Beadle Smith is usually a man of pretty sound judgment, to be fair.
Absolutely. So,
but it just goes to show that all these senior generals, they get it wrong sometimes. And, you know, Beadle Smith was 100% wrong on that. I mean, the real tragedy of the Italian campaign is that the Italians had got it into their head that the Allies weren't landing until sometime after the 12th of September. There was absolutely no reason for them plucking this particular date. But they do so because they believe that they might be ready to negate some of the potential German aggression when the armistice is announced by the 12th of September. The point is once the armistice is signed and once they've got a plan, they need to work out their own plan as to how best to combat potential German aggression once the armistice is announced. And they believe it will take them until the 12th of September to get ready for that. Mm. And the Allies don't tell them when they're going to land, because obviously until the armistice is announced, they can't trust them. You know, okay, they've signed the armistice, but they might go and tell the Germans. They might have a change of heart. You know, who knows? You know, they are still on paper the enemy. So they can't trust them. So the Allies can't tell them when it's going to happen. The terrible irony of all this is that actually Hitler was planning to retreat all his troops on the 9th of September to the Pisa-Rimini line. He absolutely was. I mean, the evidence that the Allies have for this move to the Pisa-Rimini line is incredibly flimsy. And yet, as it happened, that was the plan. And he was going to order it on the 9th of September. Then the Allies invade, and that goes out of the dishwater. You know, I mean, it doesn't happen after all. So the irony of it is, although the Italians plucked this date, the 12th of September, literally out of nowhere, and the reason the Allies wanted to land by at least the 9th was because they knew more German troops were pouring into Italy, and they wanted to do it before too many more arrived. You know, every passing day, more German troops would be in Italy, and therefore their job would get harder. That's the thinking behind it. The irony is that had they waited until the 12th of September, as the Italians had got it into their heads that they were going to, they would have walked into Rome. Probably. You know, but amazing. Hindsight's a great thing, right? I mean, you know, and the other thing is that what's really clear is that there's kind of general panic at the top from the Italians. But what is also clear is that the Italian leadership, its number one priority is looking after itself, not the great people of Italy. So what the risk of turning your own guns onto the Germans is that the Germans then come down like a ton of bricks and are much, much, much more heavy-handed in their dealing with the Italian leadership than they would be if they just sort of hand over their weapons and allow themselves to be rounded up. And that is absolutely what is going through the heads of Ambrosio and Badoglio and the king and all the rest of it. They're thinking, how can we get out of this with our necks intact or without being executed at a firing squad? And they're not thinking what is best for the Italian people. And unfortunately, Carboni, who is the commander of the troops in Rome, absolutely is thinking what's best for Italians and comes up with a plan, which is to issue a secret order to every senior Italian commander that the moment the Germans show any sign of aggression, they have to turn their own guns on them, you know, and flood them and overwhelm them. And then in tandem with the Allied landings, they'll prevail. The Italian leadership says to Carboni, yeah, what a great plan. Yeah, absolutely. We should definitely do that. Does nothing of the kind. Sanctions Carboni's memo, then never issues it, and instead sends exactly the opposite, sends out a mission to every single German senior Italian commander going, whatever happens, if the Germans show any sign of aggression, just throw your hands in the air and surrender. I mean, it is absolutely abject. So when Clark and his Fifth Army land at Avalanche, you know, on the Avalanche invasion at Salerno, they, A, find themselves confronting the Germans rather than the Germans retreating, and B, find themselves with absolutely zero support from the Italian troops. So two of the prerequisites which have been lined up for the invasion have proved not to be the case.
James, I just want to talk a little bit about the Germans, what they were hoping to accomplish overall in Italy by seizing Italy? Because wouldn't it seem, just thinking of Operation Overlord, wouldn't it seem that those troops would be better used in Normandy? I mean, what are your thoughts there?
Well, it's interesting because Churchill, who's the British Prime Minister, of course, he's all for taking Rome, and he wants to take Rome because he's a man who understands history and understands the kind of ancient symbolism of taking a capital that was, you know, the capital of the ancient Roman Empire, the capital of fascism, you know, major European capital, et cetera, et cetera. You know, he's all for it. But actually, the other three reasons for going into Italy are actually stronger than the reason for getting to Rome. The first reason is to finally, once and for all, get Italy out of the war. Because if Italy gets out of the war, then who's going to occupy the lands that Italian troops are occupying? Who is going to do the policing of the Balkans and Greece and the Aegean and Italy itself? Well, obviously, it's going to be the Germans. And so if that happens and Italy goes out of the war, then that means Italian armed forces too, which means the Germans are going to have to occupy those areas. And those troops are going to have to come from somewhere else. They're going to have to come from the Western Front, where not a lot is happening at the time, and the Eastern Front, where a lot is happening at the time. So the Allies make a calculated view that those troops will have to come from other theatres, and most likely the Western theatre, because that's where there's the least amount of activity and where they can most afford to lose those troops. And actually, they're quite correct. That's exactly what does happen. And that is good for Operation Overlord. Now, the fourth reason for going in, so you've got Rome knocking Italy out of the war, drawing off German troops. The fourth reason for going in is to capture the Foggia airfields. And at this time, in the autumn of 1943, it's the clock is ticking. You know, there's a directive going to the Strategic Air Forces, which is point blank, which is the destruction of the German aircraft industry and indeed the Luftwaffe itself. And the aim is to have a control of the airspace over a vast swathe of Northwest Europe before D-Day, the Operation Overlord, the cross-channel invasion. And the reason you need that and why this is an absolute prerequisite for the Normandy invasion is because the moment you land in Normandy, the cat is out of the bag, and then the race is on to see which side can build up the most decisive amounts of men and material in the bridgehead. Will it be the Allies, you've got to get into ships and unload it and load it up again and get it across the channel, which is a comparatively slow and cumbersome procedure? Or will it be the Germans who are already on the continent? So you need to slow down the Germans. And how do you do that? Well, you do that by blowing up every bridge across the River Seine, across the River Loire. You attack marshalling yards. You make sure the Reichsbahn is kind of, you know, as crippled as it possibly can be. And the Germans' ability to reinforce the bridgehead is significantly slowed up. But you can only do that with very, very low-level precision bombing. And you can only do that if you haven't got Messerschmitts and Focke Wulf 190s hovering above you to shoot you down. And so that is why it is so important to destroy the Luftwaffe, or at least push them back a long way from from Northwest Europe, so that you've got control of the airspace over that vast wave of ground, so that you can do this destructive work and hinder the Germans' ability to get to Normandy. The trouble is, in the autumn of 1943, that's not looking very likely. It's looking like a long way off. They haven't got a long-range fighter at this point. Every time the Americans send heavy bombers deep into the right, which is where the vast majority of the aircraft factories and assembly plants are, they get absolutely slaughtered to a kind of completely unsustainable level. You know, you take Schweinfurt 1 on 17th of August 1943, 315 ships go over, 60 don't come back, and a further 168 eventually get written off. I mean, that's a totally unsustainable level of losses. So that's a non-starter. So Foggia is one of the very, very few areas, flat areas in the southern half of Italy. And there you can put lots of heavy bomber groups. Yeah, you know, it's flat as a board there. You can see the distant mountains sort of, you know, shimmering blue in the horizon. But there in this bizarre plain on the coast, but, you know, maybe two-fifths of the way up on the Adriatic eastern side of Italy, is this area where you could put strategic bombers. And this becomes number one priority. And in many ways, you know, for much of the Italian campaign, and certainly in the opening months of the Italian campaign, at any rate, Italy is paying lip service to the tyranny of Overlord. You know, it is. Well, you can't have that many landing craft because we need them for Overlord. You know, we need to get to where we need to get to, because we need to get Foggia so that we can support Overlord. But by committing first six and then subsequently 21 bomb crews to Foggia, that's taking up a huge amount of assault shipping space and shipping supplies and just supply lines, which suddenly means that the army's on the ground slogging their way north in this terrible conditions and, you know, against these rivers and up these mountains and all the rest of it, are having to compete against the air forces, strategic air force, 15th Air Force, for shipping space. Because obviously, you know, you need about 50 guys on the ground to get a crew of 10 in the air. Plus all the parts, tents, rations, ammunition, bombs, bomb racks, tools, vehicles, fuel dumps, ordnance dumps, all the things that go with managing a vast bomber fleet.
Yeah, so earlier you mentioned the Italian leadership and how sort of the last thing they're thinking of is the Italian people. And so one of the things that I think that kind of shines through in your book and I think just with any fair study of the Italian campaign is really what this means to the Italian people themselves. Let's think about for a second what the war has meant for them, because Italy wasn't in the war at the beginning. It's Mussolini who takes Italy into the war with really crass opportunism in the summer of 1940, trying to profit on France's demise and Britain's overstretched, difficult strategic position, bringing war to North Africa and the Mediterranean, and ultimately bringing war to Italy itself, first through Allied bombings and eventually through these invasions. And then, Jim, like bringing civil war to Italy, which is what's going on here. Once you have that sort of Mussolini rump regime in the north, and you have, you know, anti-fascist partisans there, and then you have where these so-called liberated areas where our armies are operating, I mean, the people are caught in between, you know, and I think that the humanity of this kind of shines through in your book. So in your view, you know, what does this war cost the Italian people? What is it like for them? What is it like to be an average person somewhere in this battle area, even in Allied controlled areas? What are the challenges and the circumstances?
So it's an absolute catastrophe for Italy. I mean, you know, the whole war was an absolute catastrophe. They couldn't afford it. They weren't modern enough to be able to do what they wanted to do. And, you know, they got caught short. You know, Mussolini's ambition, you know, was seen for the kind of, you know, failure that it was. And, you know, the summer of 1943, they're absolutely spent, the Italians. They're done. They're broke. They haven't got any shipping left. They haven't got any trucks left. They haven't got any railway lines left. They've all been destroyed by Allied bombers. Their ships have been sunk. Armies in tatters, air forces in tatters, navies in tatters. Everyone's fed out of it. No one's got any food. No one's got any money. They need out. But they're in a rock and a hard place because most of Italy is already kind of swarming with German troops. And they know that the moment they leave, they're in big doo-doo. And what happens is a kind of worst of all worlds, which is that the Allies make a successful landing, but they get embroiled in a kind of sort of horrible slugging match, which means that, you know, everyone behind the front line is stuck with the Germans and subsequently the kind of sort of, you know, the new fascist regime under a kind of liberated Mussolini. Or they're in the Allied sphere, which in the extreme south is sort of okay. But in the major conurbations, such as Naples, it's an absolute horror story because, you know, Naples is the third largest city in Italy of 900,000 people living there. And, you know, everything is broken. You know, the water mains is broken, electricity is broken, there's no food, there's no means of getting it there. And this is because the infrastructure, the communication system, transportation system in southern Italy is just completely broken. It's broken partly by Allied bombs, partly by being in the war, and partly by scorched earth policy by the Germans as they retreat. And, you know, it's interesting. I got this diary by this medical doctor, chief medical officer for the German 14th Panzer Corps, called Wilhelm Maus. And Wilhelm Maus goes, you know, I do feel a bit sorry for the Italians, you know, because, you know, unfortunately, as we retreat, we're having to blow everything up. We're having to destroy quite a lot of towns and villages and stuff, you know, blowing up the streets from the beginning and the end. We've had to kind of make a mess of Naples. And we're also having to kill all the animals as well because, you know, it's sad for the Italians creating this humanitarian crisis, but this will slow up the Allies and give us a greater chance of victory and success. So I suppose one has to remember that, you know, they did put a knife into our back. So, you know, I guess they've got it coming. So that's very much the kind of sort of German view on all this. And that's what happened. So, you know, what you see is wherever You know those sort of twisters that kind of go across the kind of, you know, the Midwest or whatever, and, you know, people go out filming them, don't they? And you see this thing sort of going shh, like a sort of Warner Brothers cartoon, kind of sort of just tearing roofs off. And, you know, we've all seen pictures of these sort of terrible tornadoes that hit Florida or New Orleans or whatever. And it's just this sort of massive destruction. I always kind of think of it like that. You know, wherever the Allies are, you want to get out of the way because violence is going to come. So you've got the Germans going to destroy. So when the, you know, say there's a main road like the Via Casilina going through a town, it's like a one horse town with the kind of houses and municipal buildings either side of it. What they'll do is they'll blow up the beginning of the street and they'll blow up the end of the street so that the Allies have a headache before they can go it. They'll destroy every bridge nearby, every bridge that they can possibly use by the Allies is blown up. Any kind of infrastructure like a power station or something like that, or a water system or something like that, the Germans blow it up. If they see animals, generally speaking, they kill them as well. If they're kind of, you know, they're retreating, they wouldn't do it in the area in which they're operating. And then, you know, where they're making big areas, you know, of defense, such as the Bernhard Line or the Gustav Line, which stretches from one side of the peninsula to another, any village which happens to be in that line, they're just cleared out. Just, there you go, go. And all the young men are kind of lined up to work for the organization top, which is a German labor service. And everyone else is just, you know, well, you know, if you're Italian, you sort of think, well, where do I go? And they go, not our problem. Sorry, just tough. Off you go. You know, and so people end up living in caves and stuff. I mean, you know, I was sort of following this group of people who end up in this sort of mountain, really high, about sort of 2,000 feet high, in the mountains. And, you know, one of them gives birth to a baby on the 28th of November, 1943, in the snow on the top of this mountain. I mean, can you imagine? I mean, it's absolutely shocking. So it's horrible. And, you know, the writing is on the wall, even when they're in Salerno, because, you know, these little sort of places that we know as sort of pinpricks in the battle map, Altavilla, Battipaglia, Eboli, these kind of places, totally erased from the kind of, you know, they are totally, totally destroyed. You know, I'm now working on Casino. Casino is 100% destroyed. There is not a single building in the town that was standing at the beginning of September 1943, still standing by the 17th of March 1944. Not one. Not a single one. And, you know, it's full of dead bodies. It gets hot in summer. It becomes malaria. And obviously, malaria stands for malaria, you know, bad air. And it's mad air because it's full of horrible mosquitoes, which are going to make you ill and potentially kill you. I mean, I remember reading this quote from this Italian, and he said, you know, we were abandoned spiritually, materially, culturally. We were just completely abandoned. You know, they're just... So from an Italian point of view, you are just caught in a period of anarchy in which on any given day you could come under the command of the Germans, of the Allies, of no one at all. You know, there's looting. There's people doing anything they can just to survive. So it's, it sort of goes into kind of sort of Lord of the Flies, kind of dog eat dog kind of stuff. There's you know, there's obviously lots of cases where communities come together and work for common good and all the rest of it. And, you know, incredible stories of that. But who's in charge here? Well, no one knows. I mean, because it's a hiatus. And, you know, this is what happens to civilians in the middle of a war zone. I mean, you know, I've got a map and it's got all the kind of towns and villages around Casino. And it just says the percentage of how much destruction was. It's like 96%, 100%, 98%. 87%, 92%. I mean, there's literally nothing within kind of 25 miles that is less than 80% destroyed.
Jim, let's switch subject to Allied morale. You write in your book, quote, maintaining morale was absolutely paramount because as all Allied commanders were keenly aware, an army with poor morale was no army at all. So tell us about some of the morale challenges for the Allies and how well they were met.
Yeah, I am in constant awe of what makes someone from Iowa want to be fighting over a scrap of muddy ground somewhere north of the Volturno. I mean, why would you? It's just amazing. And I also remember reading a note by John Slessor, who was a deputy Allied air commander in Italy. And he says, you know, one of the problems is we're not tough enough. You know, you look at the Germans expect to survive on 4 days rations of what we would, you know, our American British troops expect to have in one. Okay, that's, now that is nothing to be proud of from a German point of view. The only reason their German troops are surviving on for 4 days of what Americans and British would expect for one is because they don't have any choice in the matter, because they don't have enough of anything. And, you know, frankly, they should have surrendered years ago. You know, there is a huge benefit to looking after your men and making sure they do get Coca-Cola and turkey dinners on Thanksgiving Day and on Christmas, and that they are getting plenty of cigarettes and chocolate and all this kind of stuff. And crucially, mail. No one is better at moving mail around the world than the Americans. I mean, they're the guys who developed the V-mail, you know, this idea that you photograph it and then you put it on film and develop it at the other end, which means you can fly it over. It means it's much quicker. You know, it's small things, making sure that you've got loads and loads of rest camps, that you rotate troops out, that you don't beat them within an inch of their lives. I mean, the rule of thumb on infantry units, for example, is that once you've got 20% casualties, you pull them out of the line. Now, in Italy, that's just not possible. So it's very often, it's kind of 50%, 60%, very, very often kind of 30 or 40%. The Germans, on the contrast, it's kind of 80%. Then you think about pulling them out of the line, which is insane, by the way. I mean, militarily, that makes no sense whatsoever at all. But keeping morale is a really, really thorny business, and it's a constant kind of, you know, carrot and stick process. I mean, you know, I think I shared with you, John, this letter by Clark that he writes on the 12th of December 1943, where, and this is following the desertion of 40 men from the 34th Red Bulls Division, and he's livid about this. He's absolutely livid. Basically, they've gone away and they've decided, you know what, let's just go to Naples. We can't be asked. We don't want to fight in these mountains anymore. It's horrible. And, you know, one has a huge amount of sympathy for them, frankly. but he goes and has a one-to-one with Charles Dot Ryder, the 34th Red Bulls divisional commander, says, listen, I think you're a great bloke. I think you're a really good commander. But anything like that happens again, you're fired. I just want you to know that right now. You've got to sort this out. You know, 34th Red Bulls haven't had any worse losses than anybody else. And in fact, in terms of men dead, it's kind of 392 versus 541 for the Texans. So actually, you're getting off better. And, you know, he is absolutely livid about this. But as an army commander, he completely gets that you know, it's very fragile, the limits of authority that are keeping men at the front, you know. So what are you going to do with someone who deserts? Well, you put them in the glass house, you know, send them to prison, give them hard labor for 2 years. But reality is you're going to do 6 months. Then you're going to be given a choice of kind of going back to your unit. And in that time, you've had 6 months of life that you might not have had if you were shot the next, you know, blown up by a shell the next day instead of desertion. So, you know, these things are really, really difficult. And anyway, he sends out this message basically saying, everyone has to understand why we're fighting. You know, we didn't ask the Germans to fight. You know, we don't want to be involved in this war. But the only way we can win and make sure that nothing like this ever happens ever again is to beat the Germans so hard that not only are they cowed forever, anyone else witnessing it will realize that the last thing you ever want to do is take on the forces of freedom, particularly those of the United States. And frankly, when you're reading this note, you can't really argue with it, not even today. Well, even more so today when you're looking at what's going on in Ukraine and Gaza and stuff. And you can see in this note a kind of sort of combination of deep frustration, absolute anger. And the anger is directed at the Germans for protracting this stupid war that no one wants to fight. No one wants to be in Italy. No one wants to be fighting in this normally beautiful land in these awful conditions. No one wants young men to be dying in their droves. But the sooner you beat the Germans, the sooner everyone can go home. So stop faffing about and deserting and pull your socks up and get on with it, because that's what we've got to do. It's tough. You know, you've drawn a short straw, but that's just your fate in life. You know, all of us out here, we've got a job to do, and we just need to get on with it, and we need to do it with the greatest resolve possible. So that's the stick. The carrot is the rest camps, the Coca-Cola, the all the rest of it. But of course, it's really difficult because it's raining all the time and it's miserable and it's thing. But of course, on the other hand, when those conditions are so bad, it's the small little mercies, the small little things, the extra packet of cigars that have been sent over by mom from New Jersey, the kind of, you know, the rest camp, the trips to Pompeii, those things count for 10 times as much value as they would do if you were in a kind of quite easy theater. So the point is, when you do give these guys a little break, it's got to be meaningful. They've got to get decent steak dinners. They've got to get booze. They've got to have cinema shows, and they've got to have, you know, I don't know, what's his name? Not Bing Crosby, but, you know, these kind of guys. They've got to come over and, you know, entertain the troops and Marlena Dietrich. And, you know, they've got to be given something that really counts. And somehow the Allies managed to kind of pull that off, just about. There's lots of moments where it's really, really touch and go, but boy, these guys just keep going. But it's absolutely clear, you know, you only got to read all these diaries and stuff, and you realize these guys are absolutely spent. I mean, I've just been reading this guy, the British guy, who is severely traumatized by a patrol that goes wrong. You know, very proven combat leader, nothing wrong with his credentials, you know, brave as a horse, all this kind of stuff. But he suffers from, he's in shock, and he's got combat fatigue. You know, he is in hospital in a really bad way. Literally 10 days later, he's out and he's back, you know, and he gets sent up to Anzio, just like that. And lo and behold, guess what happens to him? He gets, you know, blown to pieces by an ATA. He shouldn't have been there.
And James, just speaking of morale, I mean, switching over to kind of from the German side, Albert Kesslering, let's talk about him for a minute, because as a German commander, you say that history has been too generous to him. And
definitely.
Speaking of morale, you know, it seems like he did have a lot of advantages in terms of defensive terrain, a lot of manpower, things like that. Still not successful. Was he trying to hold on to too much? Was Rommel correct in saying, we'd be better not to try to hold everything? He did seem to send troops in over and over again who got annihilated. I mean, tell us a little bit more about Kesselring and what maybe.
Yeah, I think people are kind to him because generally they kind of think of the very kind of stoic defense of the Germans and stubborn defense. And, you know, he gets a lot of the plaudits for that. And also he's considered, in inverted commas, you know, a good German, which he wasn't, incidentally. He was an out-and-out Nazi, and he, on his watch, some absolutely horrific massacres took place. You know, I mean, I'm not in favor of executing anybody, but by the mores of the day, he deserved to be on the end of a rope, and he was lucky to get away with it, frankly, by the standards of the time. So he makes his big mistake. So he's a Luftwaffe general, and he's been a very good sort of, you know, he's a good organizer, and he's quite a good diplomat, which made him a very good sort of commander-in-chief of German forces in the south. But you know, in 1941, 42. But at that time, his was an administrative role. You know, he was like a commander-in-chief role rather than a kind of actual battlefield commander role. But for the Italian invasion, he is sort of elevated to becoming an army group commander, which gives him specific control over ground troops and ground troops decisions. And frankly, he doesn't really have the experience to do that, and he's not very qualified for it. And his catastrophic mistake goes right back to Operation Avalanche and Salerno beachhead, the counterattack. So what happens is he thinks that there's this little invasion by 8th Army in the boot, and they're still struggling through the mountains. And he hasn't got very many troops in the southeast in what we would call a Puglia, and this covers the ports of Taranto, Bari, Brindisi, and that southeastern area. And it's actually one of the areas of Italy which is not particularly mountainous. But what he thinks is this is the main invasion front. This is the main effort by the Allies. So what we'll do is I'll just sort of tidy up Rome, and then I can shove everything at kicking the Allies back into the sea. Once I've done that, I can then turn everything, all my energies, onto 8th Army and sweep back down and reconquer the whole of southern Italy. That's his plan, but it's predicated on him kicking 5th Army out into the sea again, and he doesn't do it. So having chucked all his eggs in one basket, and when I say all his eggs in one basket, he's got 8 divisions to play with. One stays in Rome to keep Rome under order. One is the 1st Fallschirmjäger Division, which is a very lightly armed paratrooper to airborne division, which doesn't have any heavier weapons of any kind at all, but you know, it's good for sort of mine laying and a few rear guards, but that's basically it. But it's also been depleted by a number of the units from the 1st Fallschirmjäger being sent over to support the units at Salerno. So he's got, you know, 6.5 divisions directed against 4 American and British divisions and a few special troops at Salerno, and he fails. And having put all his eggs in one basket and it then failing, he's then in big trouble, because what's happened while his attention has been diverted at Salerno, the British have landed the 1st Airborne Division out through the back door at Taranto, and the Fallschirmjäger can do nothing about it. They just don't have the heavy weapons or the scale or the numbers of men to be able to do anything other than do these sort of occasional rear guards and mine laying. And so as a consequence of that, Fodger airfields are captured on the 27th of September. So that's, you know, less than 3 weeks after, it's hardly barely 2 weeks after the invasion. And that's a catastrophe for the Germans, because that is the most important bit of real estate south of Rome. Once you've lost that, there is no point in fighting south of Rome at all. The problem is, although Salerno is a failure for Kesselring, Hitler's rather impressed by his robust counterattack and goes, actually, I've changed my mind. I don't want to go to the Brindisi-Pisa, the Pisa-Rimini line. Actually, you can fight for every yard south of Rome, and I don't want you to give up an inch. And if you do, it's got to be, you know, over, you know, fighting to the last man kind of stuff. And suddenly Kesselring is being hoisted by his own petard, because as a German commander, the last thing you want is a Hitlerian spotlight on you. You know, that's an absolute disaster, because the moment you have that, your freedom to maneuver is just out the window. So suddenly everything he does has to be checked off by the OKW, the Combined General Staff, i.e. Hitler. And Hitler just goes, no, keep defending. I really think, mein Führer, that we should pull back from the Bernhard line now. Absolutely not. So consequently, he hasn't got enough men, and he's not handling his men very well. And what's happening is because they are getting to a situation where they are allowing 80% of divisions to be slaughtered or captured or you know, wounded, missing, killed, they then have to plug these gaps. So any new replacement division as it reaches the front is constantly being split up and never operating as a cohesive whole. And when you lose your cohesion, you also lose morale, and you lose your kind of means of operating efficiently, because every division has its own divisional staff, which has its processes of sending forward equipment and men and material and all the rest of it up to the front. It has its own kind of logistics team. And if you're sending off a battalion here and a company there and all over the place and temporarily attaching them to someone else, it's just a total mess. And that's what happens to the Germans. And I find it absolutely staggering that there hasn't been more critical analysis of the German performance in Italy, which, you know, everyone says, oh, gosh, it was so hard, it was so stubborn, all the rest of it. It was terrible because the command was so bad. I mean, hats off to the bravery of the guys who are manning these positions, but I would argue that you don't need particularly well-trained men to kind of fire a machine gun from a mountain position surrounded by rocks. I mean, you just got to hold it there. And you know, it's absolutely clear from reading these diaries of Germans who are at the front, it's mayhem. They just think, you know, we wake up and it's quiet today. We're already worried because we can't understand why it's quiet. You know, this is obviously a harbinger of something much worse that's going to come. You know, we go to sleep wondering whether we'll ever see another dawn or we'll ever go to bed ever again. Oh, phew, made it through today, but, you know, half my platoon is gone. You know, it's all this kind of stuff. I mean, you know, they're getting slaughtered on a scale that you would just, it's hard to comprehend.
Yeah, it really is.
It's so brutal. I mean, I was reading a diary yesterday of this guy, and he's like, you know, this new dispatch rider's come up. He's a really sweet-faced boy. He's called Sitterling. You know, he's 17 years old. The next day, you know, I've got to send Sitterling off for a message because, you know, we can't hold this position anymore. I've got to tell the companies to pull back, but I can't get through on the phone, so I'm going to have to send Sitterling. Sitterling doesn't come back, you know. 2 days later, he's reported one of the guys who's got killed. 17.
Yeah. And there's thousands and thousands and thousands of guys like that happens. They're just swallowed up in this morass. And it, so, yeah, I mean, well, we've reached the end of our time. But just to repeat, the name of the book is The Savage Storm, The Battle for Italy, 1943. You've heard James talk about it so eloquently. I highly recommend the book because not only is it sort of cutting edge in terms of the historiography and the importance of the Italian campaign, but also bringing it to life and also, I think, on the human side, too. it's a very balanced account, you know, from the ground up, from the Italian perspective, the German, the British, the American, so on and so forth. So congratulations again on the book, James. It's been an honor.
Well, thank you, John. It's hugely appreciated. Thank you so much for having me on and for giving me such a good airing. It's been great to talk to you all.
Absolutely. A pleasure. So, John Long, please tell us about today's We Salute You.
Today on our We Salute You feature, we honor the service of Corporal Harold Creighton of West Virginia, a soldier whose sympathy for a grieving family continues to inspire, even if he himself may have never realized the full impact of his act of kindness. Harold Creighton was born in Harrison County, West Virginia in 1915, the son of a coal mine foreman. By 1933, most likely in response to the trials of the Depression, Harold had enlisted in the U.S. Army, Company A of the 10th Infantry Regiment. On June 7, 1941, Harold married Dorothy L. Morgan in Wilmington, Delaware. But by the end of that year, of course, the new bridegroom found himself at war. Somewhere along the way, Harold was reassigned to the 453rd Amphibian Truck Company as a driver for the innovative land and sea vehicles, usually called ducks, a vital link in getting materiel to the beaches on D-Day. On June 6, 1944, Creighton drove his duck onto Omaha Beach. Needless to say, his vehicle would have been a prime target for German defenders of the beach, but somehow he escaped unharmed. The next day, Harold Creighton was on the beach when something along the seawall caught his eye. It was a black-bound Bible, lost in the sand by some soldier in the chaos of the day before. Instinctively picking it up, Creighton found a name and a hometown written in the Bible, Raymond Hoback of Bedford, Virginia, along with the names of his parents and the fact that the Bible had been given as a Christmas gift from his mother prior to the war. Creighton did not know the fate of Raymond Hoback, but he spontaneously determined to return the Bible to his parents. In a letter to the Hobacks a few weeks later, Creighton wrote that he was certain that, quote, they would want the book returned. I am sending it knowing that most Bibles are a book to be cherished. His letter also expressed sympathy and hopefulness for the Hobacks. You have by now received a letter from your son saying he is well. I sincerely hope so. In fact, what the Hobacks had received the month before was the worst news imaginable. Raymond, a member of Company A, 116th Regiment, one of the famous Bedford boys, had in fact been killed on Omaha Beach, his Bible lost in the maelstrom, and his body never identified. In addition, a second Hoback son, Raymond's brother Bedford, had also fallen that day on Omaha Beach, along with 18 other men from Bedford killed in action, likely in a single hour. Now, stop to imagine what Creighton's gesture must have meant to the grieving family in Virginia when his package arrived. Mr. and Mrs. Hoback had lost two sons. The dreaded telegrams had arrived a mere day apart. They were dealing with unimaginable grief as they processed this crushing news. Then, suddenly, unexpectedly, a tangible memento arrived that had belonged to one of their lost sons, a cherished artifact from the battlefield, bringing comfort and meaning to their loss. Raymond Hoback's Bible, as well as the letter from Harold Creighton, became cherished family heirlooms. Mother Hoback later said that if she could not have Raymond back, she was glad she could still have his Bible. The story of Raymond and Bedford and of the returned Bible became legendary and in time known around the world. It is told in Alex Kershaw's poignant book, The Bedford Boys, and represented in a sculpture at the National D-Day Memorial. Untold numbers of visitors have contemplated the nature of loss, faith, and remembrance represented by the simple black Bible. Last year, Raymond Hoback's Bible, the letter from Harold Creighton, and other artifacts were donated to the National D-Day Memorial by Lucille Bogus, the last surviving sibling of the Hoback brothers. As we approach the 80th anniversary of D-Day, it forms a centerpiece of our collection that still brings tears to the eyes of many visitors. As for Harold Creighton, he returned home safely after the war and remained in the Army, eventually retiring with 23 years of service and the rank of warrant officers. He and Dorothy raised a son and lived in West Virginia, Maryland, Florida, and New York in the ensuing years. Dorothy died in 1981, and Harold lived until 1993. Both are buried in a niche at Arlington National Cemetery. It's unclear if Harold remained in later contact with the Hobacks or if he ever knew how much his spontaneous act of kindness meant to a family who had lost so much and to a community that had paid so high a cost for victory. But we at the National D-Day Memorial know, and we appreciate the act of compassion that shines across eight decades. Harold Creighton, we salute you. Thank you for your service, and thank you for bringing comfort to a Greenby family, and thank you for doing your part to save the world.
That's such a powerful addition to our collection, and I often wonder if he ever had any sense of what that meant to the family, because it brought so much peace and comfort to them. But an incredible piece to have. We have visitors who ask to come see it now, and it's so great that we have it for them to look at.
Yeah, it's incredibly moving.
Yeah.
I mean, right there, just in that simple book, you know, mm-hmm. Normandy invasion, in a way, that it personalizes it on a level that's kind of hard to pinpoint.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, I think a testament to the loss in so many communities across the country, mm-hmm. across, everywhere. Across the world, these villages. These were young men and women who gave their all, and it had a tremendous impact on families for lifetimes and generations. Yeah.
It is very unique. I am not aware of another example of an artifact like that returning to the family when the soldier was himself lost, never identified. Obviously, the personal effects of a man who fell would be returned to the family. But normally, if, you know, a body was not recovered, everything lost, you know, with the body was also not recovered. But this Bible came home, and again, the family just cherished what it meant.
And Raymond hadn't found it, Graves Registration people had found it and knew it was Hoback's diary, then it would have gone through the quartermaster corps, the effects bureau, and all that. It would have gotten back to them, but I dare say it wouldn't have been the same. I mean, they would have been glad to have it, but to have a soldier find it and send it to them.
Exactly.
That's maybe what's so poignant.
Especially considering the amount of things. I know that famous excerpt from Ernie Pyle where he talks about just how many things were on the beach. Everything you can imagine that you would find, and random items that were part of someone's life. And it is a miracle that this made it back to the family the way it did.
It really is. And we've all been on that beach, and we know how big it is and how the tides pound and all this kind of stuff. Imagine all that stuff there a day later. It's really interesting how that all went down. Well, I'd like to reiterate our thanks to my buddy James Holland for coming on today. It's just been such a pleasure and an honor to have you, as always, my friend.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much, all of you. It's been a lot of fun.
Come see us again at the memorial next time you're around.
Yeah, you bet. I need no second invitation, I can assure you.
Absolutely. Great to have you. Well, you can email our team at podcast@dday.org. Again, that's podcast@dday.org. If you're enjoying our discussions on World War II and its lasting impact, subscribe to this podcast, share it with your friends, rate it, leave us a review. Help us share the lessons and legacies of D-Day and World War II. Thanks for joining us, everybody. Take care.
Someone Talked is a production of the National D-Day Memorial Foundation in partnership with Watts Creative Studios. Views expressed are not necessarily those of the foundation. This program was supported by a grant from Virginia Humanities. Virginia Humanities connects people and ideas to explore the human experience and inspire cultural engagement. As the State Humanities Council, Virginia Humanities reaches millions in its estimated annual audience through festivals, grants, fellowships, digital initiatives, teacher institutes, radio programs, podcasts, apprenticeships, and school programs. Headquartered at the University of Virginia in Charlottesville, Virginia Humanities works to serve Virginians in every corner of the Commonwealth. To learn more, visit virginiahumanities.org. Located in Bedford, Virginia, the community that suffered the highest known D-Day loss per capita in the United States, Congress warranted the establishment of the nation's monument to D-Day in this emblematic American homefront. Receiving no federal or state funding, the memorial is operated and maintained by a private foundation and donor support. Explore the National D-Day Memorial, plan your visit, and learn more about upcoming events at dday.org. Join the conversation. Email our team at podcast@dday.org.
It's no military secret that I love you.
Hey, how about romancing?
If you can keep a secret,
well, can I take you dancing?
If you'll take my heart and keep it, I'm not saying a word. I'm careful whatever I do.
I guess everyone's heard. I want to give all my love to you.
If you gotta talk to someone, don't give any information. It's smart to be a dumb one. Simply change the conversation.
Let's talk about love.
That's what I'm thinking of.
It's no secret, no secret. It's no secret that I love you.